Morning, everybody. Very, very faithful few. But for understandable reasons, and in a way for good reasons, we're not so many here this morning. So welcome. I kind of feel a bit like an air steward when I give the safety notices. So please wear a mask at all times. Please use the toilets to my left. Follow the arrows as you go around the church, and please don't engage in conversation with others as you leave and give each other space. And that makes this sound like the unfriendliest church in Christendom, but maybe it's also a very caring church for saying that and caring for the well-being of each other and the wider community. But I want you to look at this video. Yes. Did you get that? How to sign welcome. So watch it again, and then we'll welcome each other into church, and we'll welcome all of the people who are going to be watching this on YouTube afterwards. So I'll show it to you all again. Okay, you got that? So we welcome each other to church. Welcome. Welcome. And can we welcome everybody who's watching on YouTube? Welcome. Great. And then the next one, we start the traditional way of starting a church service is to wish peace to people. I like this one. One more time. What happened? One more time. I like this one. It's really good. It's kind of conflict and then peace. Okay, so we wish each other peace. Isn't that nice? Psalm 29. Ascribe to the Lord, you powers of heaven. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due to his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is mighty in operation. The voice of the Lord is a glorious voice. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon skip like a calf and Syrian like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord splits the flash of lightning. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees writhe and strips the forest bears. In his temple, all cry glory. The Lord sits above the water flood. The Lord sits enthroned as King forevermore. The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord shall give his people the blessing of peace. Let us pray. We come before your sight, O God, as those accused with our consciences as witness. We pray, not daring to ask what we are not worthy to receive. Lord, you know everything that drives us to confess to you, what we are ashamed of, and the sins we were not afraid to commit. With these words, we yield to you our hearts and minds, and commend to you what we say, but not what we have done. Spare us, O Lord, and forgive the sins we confess. Have mercy on those who call to you, and because our senses are weak, in comprehending your mysteries, grant, Lord, the things we do not ask because of the hardness of our hearts, and grant us pardon through Jesus Christ, our Lord. God is slow to anger and full of compassion. He forgives all who humbly repent and trust in his Son as Saviour and Lord. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Amen. Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. In the beginning, Lord, I was alone, like the earth, before your Spirit moved over the waters. I was formless and empty, and darkness filled the depths of my heart. Then it was as if you declared, "Let there be light." And out of the darkness I began to see hope, like a shimmering ray of love breaking through the parting clouds at the conclusion of night. In the beginning, Lord, I was alone. But when I saw you in the light, I was no longer afraid. You held out your hand, and though I had a choice, I had no choice. Because to refuse was to embrace again the darkness. In the beginning, Lord, I was alone. Now I feel again a part of your creation, loved, wanted, needed family. In the light of your presence, I hold out my heart that others might glimpse through it your reflection and be drawn from the darkness that I once embraced into the light of your sunrise, the brightness of your face. And we'll play "I Will Survive."
Thank you.
Mark's Gospel. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John into the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." There comes a point in January when I'm not sure if it's still okay to say Happy New Year. By mid-January, it feels as if the year is already quite old. And normally the second week of January is full of all the meetings you postponed before Christmas and working on emails that you had quietly set aside. Maybe this year is a little different. And as I've said before, there's a real imbalance of work at the moment. Some are hindered by not being able to get on with things because of the lockdown, and others are overwhelmed by the responsibility they have to keep people safe. Today is the first Sunday in the new season of Epiphany, the season in which we celebrate Jesus as the light of the world. We tell the story of the ministry of Jesus, and today we begin with two accounts, the account of the creation of the world, the new beginning, and the baptism of Jesus. In the beginning, God. The first chapter of the Bible is a hymn to the Creator God. It would have been recited in the temple in Jerusalem, with everyone joining in. And it describes the creation not from the perspective of a modern-day rational science, but in a way it is to enable us to view our place in the world and our relationship with the source of life, with life itself. We imagine the moment when God creates the world out of nothing. There is only a formless void. But there is water. The water of chaos. The water in which there is no order, no meaning, no purpose. And out of this water, the world comes into being. God's breath moves across the face of the water, and then God speaks, "Let there be light," and there was light. Spirit and word. We learn in the first few verses of Scripture just how God operates. God is spirit, not matter. God brings life into being through a word. God is the illumination of the world. God has made it possible for us to see, or at least sense, the world in all its beauty and its ugliness, to understand its meaning and purpose. And in Jesus, God recreates the world. He comes to the River Jordan, the very place where the Hebrews had crossed into their promised land, that new beginning for a wandering tribe of people. He meets his relative, John the Baptizer. John has been pulling in the crowds with his sharp message. He's required his followers to take a ritual washing. He was busy plunging one person after another into the water of freedom, the water of promise, the water of hope. It's a bit of political theatre, rather like Extinction Rebellion or civil rights activities. The crowd gathered in the place so important for their collective memory. They symbolically declared themselves to be on the side of freedom. John's baptism was of water, but he said someone would come whose baptism would be of spirit. John was the prophet. The one to come would be the real deal. So let's pay some attention to what happens next. Jesus submits himself. He allows John to take hold of him and plunge him in the water. Water is cleansing, refreshing, renewing. But it can also be dangerous. You can drown. You can have a heart attack if it's too cold. Water is a powerful force. You can use it to create electricity. It can sink mighty ocean liners. It can transform itself from stillness and calm into a tsunami. It can wreck houses, streets, towns. And water in the Bible represents the goodness of creation. Rivers flow from the Garden of Eden. God's Spirit brought the world into being through breathing on the water. But it also represents chaos. It is the primordial state. Noah endured 40 days and nights of rain floating on the waters as the rest of the world had succumbed to this chaos. So like Noah, Jesus faces the raw element of water. Always the same question. Would it be his death or his life? Will the waters destroy us or redeem us? Well, the Bible tells us the answer. For when Jesus is lifted from the water, the heavens open, the Spirit descends like a dove. Jesus has survived, and more than survived, he is transformed. And just as a dove had told Noah it's going to be all right, there is a hovering dove over the head of Jesus. The heavens are torn asunder. Direct communication between heaven and earth. This was a thin space. First the Spirit, and then the Word. You are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. God recreates the world through Jesus, the embodiment of God's Spirit and Word. So in the first few verses of Genesis, we read of the world being created through the Spirit and the Word. In these opening verses of Mark's Gospel, we read of the recreation of the world through Spirit and Word. Jesus descending into the chaotic water of Jordan was letting go. It was a death to the chaos of his day and age, and arising through the water of liberation into new life. And not for nothing do Christians equate our baptism with death and resurrection. Not for nothing do we renew our baptismal vows on Easter Sunday. Indeed, in the early church, baptism would only take place on Easter Sunday. So we have a narrative coming to us from Scripture, a narrative of renewal, which is not just a simple lived happily ever after story, but a renewal which is available in every day and age. There is no point then in telling the gospel story unless we can see ourselves in it. When I was at school, I think I quite liked geography, but did not pay a lot of attention to it. And then when I became a school teacher, at a school in Blackburn, I was appointed as RE teacher and music, teaching RE and music. But at the first Christmas, the geography teacher left, and the school had not managed to replace him. So I was given the O-level geography class. I was always just one chapter ahead of the rest of the class in the textbook. But I realized more recently when I had some contacts with the geography department at Queen Mary University that there's an awful lot more to geography than map reading and Oxbow lakes. But I digress. We can begin to see ourselves in the story of the baptism of Christ if we actually look at the rather carefully constructed geography in the story. John is in the wilderness. He's on the periphery. The center of action would have been Jerusalem, but the people leave Jerusalem to come to John and the Jordan. And Jesus comes from Nazareth. We're told where he comes from, nowhere special. And as I've said, the Jordan itself is the site of freedom. In this God-forsaken place, among the God-forsaken people, the Savior, who on the cross declared himself God-forsaken, receives a vision of a God who rescues from the water of chaos, who gives light and hope to the world through an ever-abiding spirit and a profound word. Through God we can survive, and more than survive, for in God there is life, abundant life. We can see ourselves in this story if we see ourselves in the paradox of the God-forsaken who are redeemed by God. And the word chaos certainly springs to mind when we think about our current situation. Yet at the same time, we also have some order. Each of us, in our own way, will be making some order out of the chaos. Many people are working very hard to ensure that we do return to a semblance of order. They are researching, creating vaccines, distributing them, injecting them, and we must be very grateful for them. And many people are calming the nerves of their children, their families, their neighbors, and people in their care. And we should be grateful to them. And of course, it isn't an ideal situation. The world is in an exceedingly difficult place, but it has not descended into a primeval chaos. Human creativity can win out. And this is quite a baptism for humanity. We sort of need a geography of the pandemic. It is in the God-forsaken places that wonderful things have happened. Out of all the distress, the grief, the heartache, the heart-searching, a new order of cooperation can appear. And we have been let down as well. There are those who make mischief in social media. There are those who have procrastinated, underestimated, undervalued human life. We can look to the powers of Jerusalem or the crowds who have gathered on the River Jordan. We can look at the failed policies of the populist or the anti-vaxxers and see chaos. Or we can look to the collective spirit of humanity battling against a virus which not only caught us unaware, but has also shaken our way of life. There is a spirit in the air, a dove for our time. Having been plunged into the chaotic waters, we need to know that we are coming up not just for air, but to hear the word of God. For the message to the God forsaken is that you are not abandoned. No matter how big the mess, there is a world that is being renewed. None of us should be surprised if we feel that we are sinking. We should accept that our frustrations are perfectly normal in the circumstances. If we feel down about the state of the world or our personal situations, especially if the pandemic has thwarted our plans, taken away our employment or accommodation, then that is a normal response to our abnormal situation. The chaos of the world is doing its work on our personal lives, our relationships, our aspiration, our dreams. How then do we rise? I'm reminded of Maya Angelou's poem, "And Still I Rise." We heard it at our Black History Month service last October. One verse reads, "Do you want to see me broken? Bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops weakened by my soulful cries. But the poem ends, leaving behind nights of terror and fear. I rise into the daybreak that's wondrously clear. I rise, bringing the gift that my ancestors gave. I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. For as I have said before, the virus has not created our chaos, it has exploited it. How we rise above it is in our hands. We are hopeful of a vaccine, but we can be more hopeful of God's grace. We should see ourselves as part of that crowd who left the powerful places behind and went into the wilderness. It was there that they witnessed God's creative action in their God-forsaken world. It is not too late to wish a happy new year, a happy new world. It is through each other that we will rise above this current situation. It is in being the body of Christ in the world that we will be able to offer hope to the world. We rise out of the chaos when we care for our neighbor, when we pray for those who are sick, when we plant a tree or a seed in the garden or windowsill, when we work for a society in which all are treated with equal care, consideration, and resources, when we seek forgiveness for past wrongs and take action to put them right. When Jesus rose from the water, it was as if the world had begun again. When we follow in the step of Jesus, walk his way, accept that we are his disciples, then we are people on the rise. I don't think we're quiet at the door, but the night will not last forever. Amen. that we are, Lord, we place into your hands. Everything we work for, we place into your hands. Everything we hope for, we place into your hands. The troubles that weary us, we place into your hands. The thoughts that disturb us, we place into your hands. Show us what blessing it is that we have work to do. And sometimes, and most of all, when the day is overcast and our courage faints, let us hear your voice saying, "You are my beloved one, in whom I am well pleased." You must believe in spring. So let us pray. And quietly pray to God for the renewal of humankind. We pray for those affected by COVID-19, those who are sick, those who are bereaved, those who work to find treatments and ensure vaccinations are available. We pray for nurses, doctors, ancillary health professionals, care workers, and all health service administrators and planners. We give thanks for the ecology of protection and care available to us. We pray for politicians, both local and national, who make decisions over competing priorities. Pray for those who are affected economically because of the virus, those facing homelessness and unemployment. We pray for those trapped in abusive relationships and those who are feeling depressed and anxious. We pray also for people of the majority world that they too will have access to vaccines in sufficient quantity and in good time. And this morning we pray for the United States and the preservation of the legacy of democracy. We pray for all who defend people's right to participate in government and have a say in their own country's affairs. And we think also of the people of Hong Kong. Lord, the world can seem to be chaotic, but we trust you to show us the way ahead. We thank you for the person of Jesus Christ, who has demonstrated the beauty of our humanity and the compassion of God. In his name we pray the prayer he taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, thank you for braving it this morning. It's still so cold. I think because nothing's happening on in the week, I think the building gets colder and colder and colder. But can't do anything about that. This week the Bible study will take place on Tuesday. I'll send a link. I think I've already done that, but I'll send it again. But it's on our website, so if you want to join us on Zoom for our Tuesday evening Bible study, do that. The theme for the Bible study is believing. What is believing? So that will take us through to Lent, that theme. I forgot to say last week, but thank you to all those who contributed to the Margins Christmas lunch and worked on the Christmas cards. I think that was greatly appreciated. We put all of our services online. Sashi edits them and then takes an eternity for YouTube to upload them. But if it isn't there by Sunday evening, you will be able to see it in the week. And this is especially important for those who are not able to attend. Also on the website is a page for action and prayer. And if you have any requests for prayer, please email me and I'll put them on the website. And also, there's a donations page on the website. If you want to make a donation to the church, you can do that specifically on the website. So if you're missing the collection, you can do that or use the little envelopes that you find at the door. Greetings from various people who've sent messages in saying they don't feel they can come in the circumstances, but greetings from, I can't remember who, Jill, Claudina, Graham, who else? Neil and Joanna. Various people have sent messages in saying they're unable to come. Pete and Sue unable to come, but because of the COVID situation, but want to send greetings. Let's have a blessing and then we go on our way. May the God of the dawn awaken you. May the God of sunrise stir you up. May the God of morning bless your work. May the God of noon renew your strength. May the God of sunset bring you home. May the God of dusk soothe your soul. May the God of night bring you rest. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Amen.